us. Thank you very much for joining us for this very important session. This is actually a very unique opportunity for our university, for our colleagues, to have the author of one of the very, very important recent publications that we have already discussed that in our journal club. As you know, almost every month or every 3 weeks, we have a journal club in which we discuss about the very important and hot topics in endodontics. One of the hot topics in science, rather than just endodontics, is artificial intelligence and deep learning. And I think even endodontics is a little far from this very important hot topics comparing to other medical sciences subjects around the world. And they do more work comparing to endodontists related to artificial intelligence and application of artificial intelligence in clinical situations. In Journal of Endodontics, as you know, recently our colleague, he is one of the world authority in artificial intelligence and deep learning, Dr. Fahad Omer from Aga Khan University, which is one of the very prestigious, very well-known university around the world. He published this very important article. And surprisingly, it was one of the very attractive article in our online journal club, which run by Appraise to Raise and APEC. And surprisingly, there wasn't any big challenge or any big criticism for his publication. Therefore, we asked him to give us a separate lecture from those series, so which is supported and sponsored by two universities. So this is completely and absolutely an academic session, and it hasn't got any business background or any business sponsorship. Therefore, we can now talk about it freely and without any, let's say, conflict of interest with a business base. And Dr. Fahad is going to give us an introduction about artificial intelligence and deep learning. Obviously, endodontics works as an example for him. So I am sure he's going to give us some data and some idea about what is the meaning of artificial intelligence, what is the meaning of deep learning or machine learning. And when saying such a things, he is going to speak about the application of that in medicine and medical sciences as well. Dr. Fahad, thank you very much for accepting our invitation. Some of our colleagues criticize us based on the time of our webinar, and they ask us why at this time that we are in the clinic. As you can see from my apron, as I am inside my clinic as well, but doesn't matter. We want to learn and we want to be continuous student anytime. Dr. Fahad, the stage is yours. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Professor Nikofar. And I am truly humbled by this introduction that you've given us. I am at best a novice when it comes to artificial intelligence, but I'll do my best. So I see that my screen sharing is disabled right now. Can you help me with that?
Yes, I will do.
Okay. And as far as the timing is concerned, usually we working here in Pakistan at Aga Khan University between 9 and 5. So this works better for me. I'm sorry if that caused some inconvenience to you guys, but I, as the presenter, I think I have some rights that I can, you know, undertake.
Exactly, that's right. I think you can now share because you are co-host of the meeting. So you can
just
share.
Asking me if I can, who can share, just host or co-host, and I don't have any other options available to me. I'm not sure. Let me try again. Yeah, I got it. All right. Thank you again, Professor Nikofar, and I'm truly indebted to Tehran University for inviting me and for letting me give this talk. This is a very, very interesting topic, something close to my heart, and usually get very excited about it. Just to give you a brief background as to how I became interested in artificial intelligence and endodontics, was this paper that I was reading in the recent past in IEJ. This was, I believe, from author Orhan, and he spoke about relating pathology or trying to discern pathology and radiographs using deep learning, and that it got me interested. But it was a very technical paper. I tried reading it and tried to understand. I thought it was difficult to follow. Some key terms and certain things that he had mentioned were very, very difficult to understand. And therefore, I decided to undertake a scoping review. This gave me an opportunity to understand this topic a little bit better, and also gave me an opportunity to present artificial intelligence, especially artificial intelligence endodontics, to the wider endodontic community. So that being said, just going to go ahead and start with my introduction as well. So I'm Dr. Fahad Umar. I'm right now serving as assistant professor at the Aga Khan University Hospital. I am also associate program director for the operative dentistry and endodontics residency program. I was a graduate of the same program, and been I graduated back in 2011. I've been faculty ever since. So this is the Aga Khan University Hospital, very picturesque campus. Very fortunate to be working in this hospital. It's a tertiary care hospital that was set up back in the 1980s and started off with the school of nursing and gradually built up medical college and postgraduate residency programs. This is truly a national asset for our country, not only providing research as well as academic, as well as truly international level healthcare for patients who come not only from Karachi, but also other parts of the nation, as well as internationally, we get patients who come here. Also, the facade is unreal. This architecture follows Islamic ideology of architecture. We're very fortunate to have gardens and water bodies all around campus. It gives us an opportunity to reflect and contemplate on our academic and research ideas at times whenever we get enough time out of clinics to in fact do that. So this is the Jinabai Hassan Ali Sharif building. This is the building in which the section of dentistry is housed, and this is where I spend most of my days and sometimes evenings and nights working with patients and for patients and looking after academia and research or the university hospital. And this is our faculty, the dream team. People whom I work with includes prosthodontists, periodontists, oral maxillofacial surgeons, orthodontists. Really the whole spectrum of dentistry is available at the university hospital. We also have dental hygienists. All of these people working towards the four guiding principles of our university, which is ICRA, meaning impact, quality, and research and access, relevance and access. So all of them, they really work towards achieving and highlighting these four guiding principles. And this is reflected in the outcome metrics that come out of the university in terms of both service provision, academia, and research. So I will start off with this small video.
Flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me, yeah. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me. Ooh, and I'm feeling good. Fish in the sea, you know how I feel. River running free, you know how I feel. Blossom on me.
So this was Dali, now better known as DALL-E 2. This is a artificial intelligence deep learning model that's been trained on millions of images. And now it is able to generate its own images using natural language. So this is how deep or profound an impact artificial intelligence has had. It's a latest sensation. Now that I have your attention, let me just introduce you to the concept of artificial intelligence. So artificial intelligence has now or is now becoming a disruptive technology. What disruptive technology means for the benefit of our audience is a technology that greatly alters the way businesses operate or consumers work. So previous examples of disruptive technologies would be, cars, automobiles, telephones. Likewise, artificial intelligence is soon becoming a disruptive technology, and our access or main medium towards this technology has been the smartphones. We use our smartphones for facial to unlock our smartphone. We use the facial recognition software. It is based on artificial intelligence, voice recognition using Alexa, Siri, etc. They're all based on artificial intelligence. Likewise, navigation, Google Maps, etc., works on artificial intelligence principles. Similarly, social media websites such as Instagram, Twitter, etc., they base their algorithms and bespoke their advertisements based on our search histories. They all leverage artificial intelligence algorithms to do this. This gentleman right here playing chess is John McCarthy, and he was the he was the person who actually coined the term artificial intelligence. And in his mind, what artificial intelligence meant was a machine that was able to perform human cognitive functions or human-like cognitive functions. Artificial intelligence has two main domains, which are at times intersecting one another. This is machine learning and deep learning. For clarity, I would like to say that machine learning are computer-based statistical algorithms or statistical methods that are used to analyze data. And then after analyzing this data, they make prediction based on that data, based on set parameters, such as regression, et cetera, to make predictions. Deep learning, you can say, think of it this way, is a little bit of an offshoot of machine learning. It's a kind of a machine learning, but a specialized machine learning, which is loosely based on human brain and made up of artificial neurons, artificial neural networks. And the concept of artificial intelligence is not new. It has been around since the 1950s. When the term was first coined, and it has progressed over the over the years, and sometimes the age of machine learning came, and now deep learning has come up again. When we talk about deep learning has made different appearances during this timeline. It was back in 1957 when actually the mechanical perceptron was made by Frank Rosenberg. later on. There was some research that was done on neural networks, but that didn't really work out for various reasons. This was known as the AI winter. In the late 1980s and early 1990s, again, neural network concept again came back. And this was an important application was made by Mr. LeCun, Jan LeCun. He is right now the director of research of AI in Facebook. And what he had done at that time was he had devised signature recognition algorithm known as LeNet, which was leveraged by various banks in the US to recognize signatures. But again, this neural network business took a backseat and went through another AI winter till 2012, when AlexNet did something remarkable, and we talk about more as the presentation goes along. It basically broke all the records in the image recognition challenge. And we'll talk about the image recognition challenge also a little bit more. So what happened? Why are we talking about deep learning, and why are we talking about it now? What has changed during the previous five or six decades? So let's just first try and understand the differences between machine learning and deep learning, and how deep learning is a little bit more useful. So I'm going to take this analogy of differentiating between cat and dog. So if we are going to use a regression model or a machine learning algorithm, and we want this regression model to identify between or classify between a cat and a dog, we'll have to do some kind of engineering steps. These pre-processing or engineering steps are known as feature extraction and feature selection. What that means is that a domain expert or subject expert will sit and look at a picture and decide which features will be more important and relevant to a cat, and which features are more important and relevant to a dog, for example. So they may say, a cat has pointy ears, round face, bushy tail, and dog may have long fangs, big snout. And all of this has to be done manually and fed into the algorithm. And once this is done, the algorithm, which is a machine learning regression-based algorithm, may make a classification and say, okay, you know what, this is either a dog or a cat or whatever. A training example that it is looking at. The advantage that deep learning offers over machine learning is that if given enough training examples of labeled data, such as if you have enough examples of cats and dogs, and you run it through the deep learning algorithm, initially it will make a couple of mistakes and make misclassifications. However, if you run enough iterations, it has this ability of self-correction of its internal parameters so that it can improve upon this decision-making of between cat and dog, and will not require these specialized steps of feature extraction and feature selections. And therefore, this saves a lot of labor, expensive labor of subject field experts. Another interesting fact about or advantage of machine learning or deep learning over machine learning is that if a machine learning makes a mistake, we have to, the engineers have to go back and look at why this mistake was made and have to make those appropriate corrections. Whereas in deep learning, if a mistake is made, the algorithm can run through a couple of more iterations and may improve upon its internal parameters on its own. So therefore, deep learning has a lot of advantages to offer, especially in terms of ease of use. So why now? What was happening before, which didn't let us use these algorithms since they've been around for the past 50 years? What has happened? So three things happened. number one, ImageNet happened. And I'm just going to take a few minutes talking about ImageNet. So ImageNet is a database of almost 14 million images that have been annotated, curated, and cleaned properly. And this was done, this was done by people at Stanford, led by Dr. Fifi Lee. And she talks about it, and she says that when she was working on computer vision problems, she thought they had also hit a dead end and they were not getting any benefit or any fruitful outcomes of their research. And what they realized was that what they're doing in machine learning is they have limited data set. When they have a limited or small data set, the training examples for their machine learning algorithms or any other algorithm were so low that in order to get any kind of good outcomes, they were not able to achieve it. And they make a comparison between a child and they say, okay, if you're 3-year-old, if you compare a machine learning algorithm with a 3-year-old, you will notice that the 3-year-old have had 3 years of experience, which include looking at different kind of images and having formal and informal learnings from their environment as well as parents. And you may call it supervised or unsupervised learning. So this data set was cloud sourced to 60,000 workers. And they helped curate and label these 14 million images. And then in 2007, this data set was made available to the wider community of computer vision. And they were allowed to leverage their either machine learning or deep learning algorithms against this data set so that they can improve upon it. So I think that was an important step that has furthered the computer vision domain. Likewise, other open source data sets are available to us, such as Microsoft COCO. The second thing that happened was, and now let's go back to the 1990s when Jan LeCun was working on the initial deep learning algorithm. He did not have access to the modern GPUs. So like I said before, the training examples of large data sets are very, very important for these algorithms to work properly. So for example, if a CPU was to work on an ImageNet data set of 14 million images, it will almost take forever to run that algorithm and train it on such a large, huge data set. So now we have modern GPUs available to us, and these can be physically present in your domain, or you could actually utilize them through cloud-based computing, either free or charged to Google Colab, etc. The third thing that happened was we have softwares available to us, specifically made for deep learning and machine learning, such as Keras, TensorFlow, JAX, what have you, etc. And so research in artificial intelligence is moving at a really fast pace. This is, again, attributed to all three things coming together at the right time. So now, before we move on to discussing how artificial intelligence works, let's look at natural intelligence at a cellular level. When we look at natural intelligence at a cellular level, what we notice is that a neuron consists of dendrites, which receive input from our external stimulus. This input is processed through the cell body, and then an appropriate output is made through the axon based on how strong the stimulus was or how nauseous was the stimulus. Sometimes the neuron will fire, sometimes the neuron will not fire. Depends on what kind of stimulus that neuron is set for or specialized in and what it is looking for. Likewise, this can be represented mathematically in terms of artificial neuron, also sometimes known as a perceptron. It includes, let's say, for example, input from an image. This input is assigned weights, and these weights are summed and a bias is added to this paper. Since all inputs, and this is, you don't have to go into the detail of the inputs, but for understanding that whenever we get this input data, this is a non-linear data. So a mathematical function such as a activation function has to be applied to all non-linear linearities. Function that can be applied depending on the problem. It includes a sigmoid function or ReLU, which is a more important well-known function. And this mathematical function, when applied, will make an output based on all the input data which was received on all the input received certain desired weights. Now, if we want to convert this artificial neuron into a little bit more complex model, what we just need to do is concatenate or stack these neurons together in a specialized way and attach them to one another through a mathematical function. And this is oversimplification, but this is how a neural network is formed. So this is essentially really a bunch of new artificial neurons that I explained previously stacked together. And they can perform different functions depending on what kind of functions you would want them. They just need to be packaged at the front end and at the back end with different kind of other computer-based algorithms, which I don't want to go into the detail and confuse the audience. Another important or interesting thing that I need to explain here is the difference between a shallow network and a deep network. So it's actually really simple. Whenever we have any kind of neural network, for any neural network, it has to have three layers at least. So you have to have one input layer. You have to have one hidden layer. The hidden layer actually does all the calculation. And then there has to be one output layer. And this is the output based on the calculations that were done by hidden layer. So if a network has three layers, this is described as a shallow network or an artificial neural network. If, for example, we add another additional hidden layer to this network, like in this example, it becomes a deep network. The more layers you add, the deeper the network becomes. It has its own pros and cons, but we'll not dwell on that for now. Now we move on to the applications of neural networks. So their researchers are focused on different aspects or specialized aspects of neural networks that they work on. Neural networks are leveraged in computer vision tasks, speech recognition, and natural language processing, just to name a few. But as we are more focused on computer vision tasks, therefore my talk will now focus on computer vision. So when we look at this picture, we see that a lot of things are going on here. We see that there's a sun in this picture. We see a couple of boats and there is a scene. This is day, maybe this is early morning, or maybe this is sun setting, we don't know. And when we look at this picture, the photo of the picture is taken by the eye, but the picture is actually processed and seen in the brain. With modernization, we've also learned to take very good pictures with computers and modern cameras and phones and telescopes, but we have not discovered the complete template of how we can make the computer see the pictures that they are taking or it is taking, because this is what the computer sees. This is essentially a binary code that the computer sees. It's a series of ones and zeros. And this is two-dimensional. If you want to add three dimensions to it, you can add RGB colors in it and becomes an even more complex problem to solve. And therefore, you can understand it is very difficult to make the computer understand what it is actually seeing. And essentially computer vision problems. There are various ways of looking at computer vision problems, and there are various types of computer vision problems. But we will focus a little bit more on two main problems, which are classification problem and identification problems. When it comes to computer vision, especially in healthcare. So for classification, we want to find out if something that we are looking at is diseased or non-diseased. And in terms of identification, what we want to see is we want to look at the anatomy. We have to relate the disease to the anatomy. And therefore, my talk will now further focus on classification and identification problems as we go along. So as far as the classification problem is concerned, and if we want to use a deep learning model for image classification, what one can do is just put a picture or bunch of pictures or a big data set of pictures against a neural network that I had explained earlier, which is essentially stacked up neurons, artificial neurons. And we can run this algorithm or run these pictures through this algorithm. And if it sees enough pictures, it will be able to make a prediction on it. But what we noticed in time was that two problems happen when we run a picture through a neural network. One, that this picture has pixels. And the neural network has to look at each pixel individually, which is represented, like I alluded to before, as binary numbers, ones and zeros, essentially. And when it looks at binary numbers, the complexity of the computing becomes very difficult. Number two issue is that these numbers are now flattened into a straight line. So that therefore what this will cause a problem, that all kind of spatial orientation of this picture will be lost in pixelation. So just to summarize this issue, two problems have occurred. One, that the computational efficiency to process this image through a neural network will be very high, or computational power required will be very high, especially if we increase the data set. So that's one problem. The other problem is that spatial orientation of these pixels is lost. So although this did work, but it wasn't very efficient. So researchers had to come up with a new way of tackling this problem. And therefore, I bring you to this chart. This chart represents the ImageNet error rate or ImageNet challenge error rate. And here you can see at the start, this is maybe 2010 or 11 or something, the error rate on machine learning was 28%. Then it goes down a little bit, maybe 2% by XRCE, another machine learning algorithm. But something happened in 2012. The error rate went down drastically by a factor of almost 9% or almost 10%. And this actually made the computer vision revolution or renaissance, if you speak. This was AlexNet, and it broke all the benchmarks of the previous outputs or previous errors in the ImageNet challenge. So they look at different images and they come up with the results. And so these are the errors. And you can see that after AlexNet, each year, another algorithm was getting better and better and better and better and better till 2018-9. What all these algorithms have in common is that they were all convolutional neural networks, or CNNs. The concept of CNN was also not new, or is not new. This was actually, remember I spoke at the start of the presentation about Jean Lacoon. In 1988, he actually came up with the convolutional neural network for recognition of signatures on checks. So, a guy named Alex actually leveraged that same concept and use GPUs to train his model, ImageNet challenge, and they got exceptional results. And the error rate at this point in time is actually better than humans' performance. So right now in computer vision, CNNs are now ruling the roost. So if CNN are so important, how do they work? And how did they decrease the problem that I alluded to initially at the start of the conversation on computer vision? So what they did was they put in a convolution layer in front of a deep learning model. For the sake of understanding, we can say that a convolutional layer is sort of like a stencil or a sliding window. And what this stencil is, it can be of different sizes, and you can think of that size on your own, but usually standard size of this stencil is 3x3. What that means is there is a 1, 2, 3 boxes, 1, 2, 3 boxes of pixels that will move over the image in a sliding fashion. And then once it moves over it, it will look for different things or different features that it will transfer to a layer known as the convolutional layer. Now, if you're looking at different kind of features, which include shapes and borders, you can see that the number, actually the picture size increases. And it looks at different colors. So picture size increases by a large factor. So what they do next is they add a max pooling layer. What max pooling layer does is actually down samples the number of images. So in the convolution layer, there'll be a bunch of layers or quite many layers, which may not be very useful and may not stimulate the neural network. So those layers are disincluded from the final computation. And this is done by max pooling. Max pooling, think of it as like anything which has the highest weight would get into the max pooling. Another way of doing pooling or downsampling, you can also call it downsampling, is using average pooling. If you do average pooling, what that would mean that any weights which will stimulate the neural network, average of those will be in there, but this may actually increase the sample size. So usually the layer of max pooling is added. Finally, this goes through an activation function. Remember, I told you all of this data of image processing or language processing is non-linear data. So some kind of regression, a non-linear regression has to be applied. Most of the time, a function that is known as ReLU or sometimes GELU is applied. Finally, all of this process goes through a fully connected layer. A softmax function is applied, and the algorithm is able to make a classification, whether it's a cat or not a cat or a dog or whatever. So what is actually happening in the convolutional layer? I'll just talk about it a little bit more. For the sake of understanding, I made this image as a whole cat, but actually, imagine this to be a very small window, which is 3x3. And this window looks at pixels, and this window, think of it as a stencil, which looks at different things. And the person who's making the convolution layer would actually program the algorithm with those kind of stencils. So maybe you want to look at color, so you put a color stencil in there, RGB stencil. You want to look at shapes and different kind of edges and borders, you put that stencil in there. So if you want to look at, let's say, for example, circles, you put a stencil in there and look for circles and all of them. So if there's a circle, that will be activated. If there's not a circle, the convolution layer will not be activated, not go further down in the room. So there are number of convolution layers. So the first layer usually consists of colors and shapes, such as edges and borders. And as we go deeper into the network, it becomes more and more abstract as to what the network is actually seeing. And therefore, there's a little bit of a black box effect on how actually the deep learning works. And we'll talk about that a little bit more further down in the class, in the presentation. So this slide is just there to give you a bit of an intuition on how a convolutional neural network works. So this is basically how they solve the problem of having to work with big data. The other benefit of using a sliding window was the sliding window would always maintain the spatial orientation of each pixel to the other. So number one issue was resolved by downsampling the image and just looking for specific features, which are very important using the convolution layer. And the other issue was that the pixels would lose their spatial orientation or relationship with one another can be resolved by just using a sliding window and connecting these sliding windows down the road when this goes into the fully connected layer. So with that being said, I'm just going to go through a brief summary of the article or the scoping review that we did on artificial intelligence and endodontics. So when I started doing the scoping review, we had a few questions in my mind, and the most important being, we wanted to know what are the different kind of artificial intelligence models being leveraged or utilized in endodontics. Further, we wanted to understand how they are doing in terms of diagnostic metrics, if they're doing well or all these algorithms are not working so well. And we also wanted to look at what diagnostic applications these AI models were being used in endodontics. So we did a literature search and we ended up...
Can I stop you, yes. Sorry. Sure. Because you are now moving to the endodontic part, I want to ask all the participants if they have any questions so far. Maybe good to clarify those and then move to the next part, which is more applicable. If there is any question and you want actually to say it yourself, please raise your hand and we can unmute you or unmute yourself and talk. But you may type it as well, all the participants. While the participants try to send their questions, Dr. Fahd, I myself have a question. My question is about the difference between the algorithm that you mentioned, and now you are going to show that there are different algorithms used and applied in endodontics, obviously. You mentioned that this convolutional, if I'm saying that right, CNN algorithm, it gives us different layers, but these layers are three-dimensional or just two-dimensional? Because if they are two-dimensional, they are not going to give us all the information that we need, especially if we use some sort of photography from the tooth for evaluating different things. But obviously in radiographs, it doesn't matter. But if it goes to the photographs of teeth, then this type of algorithm, CNN or others, they should send three-dimensional information to the machine for this deep learning. If I understand the way that you explained the algorithm, this is my main question. The difference between the layers or these convolutional layers, two-dimensional or three-dimensional, or texture of the surface, because texture of the surface is curved. It is not just a flat surface. I'm a bit confused about the way that the system scan or put all the information together to send it to the machine for learning.
Okay.
I hope this is not a preliminary question, but because I want actually to understand.
I think it's a very interesting question, but it's a very easy answer. It's two dimensions.
Mm-hmm.
Because the pictures that we look at through cameras or x-rays, they're always two dimensions.
So if it is two dimensions, then it comes to the resolution. We need to increase the resolution or not? Because if the resolution is not very high, then the system cannot get enough information from the image we send it to it. Am I right? So
that's a double-edged sword. If you increase the resolution too much, it's also a problem because it takes longer for the algorithm to go through the image and learn from that image or images. Mm-hmm. And therefore, you have to look for that sweet spot. But coming back to the original question again, so all the images that are done from cameras or for that matter, 3D CTs, they're actually really two-dimensional. They're rendered into a three-dimensional object. So all the studies that have been done previously in endodontics, they didn't look at the 3D rendering. They actually looked at the 2D slices. Likewise, the photographs that we do or X-rays that we look at are also 2D. And the representation, linear representation of the computer vision is also two-dimensional. But I think it's a valid query because it may come up, especially when we're looking at trying to work in 3D space in terms of making 3D scans for perhaps crown fabrication, but something that we can look into and understand a little bit better. But at this point in time, the obvious answer that comes to mind is that it looks at it in two dimensions and not in three dimensions. Because okay. Number one, it's not possible to train it in three dimensions as the data sets on which any algorithm is trained is actually two dimensional.
Yeah, but the thing is, if it is, it becomes two dimensional, then it has a lot of error in that. Am I right?
There will be a possibility of error. All right. In, error can occur from so many different other things, such as shadows, orientation, mm-hmm. postures, mm-hmm. etc.
Because in our brain, I think we filterize everything based on the cognitive issue of our brain. But in yes. machine, we don't have this cognitive access for the machine. Yes. I don't know. Do they have anything like cognition or not?
Actually, it's not really real cognition. It's all based on training, and at the end of the day, these are all algorithms which have limited use. We'll mm-hmm. talk a little bit more about that at the end of the presentation.
Okay, and yeah. There is also a comment from our friends, your co-author, Dr. Saqib. He said that very informative lecture, Dr. Fahad, thank you. Can you please elaborate a little about what is EPOCH and its role in deep learning?
Okay, so I'm going to, I think, are you able to see my screen again?
Yes, we can see your screen very well.
Okay, thank you, Saqib, for that question. Epoch really means number of iterations that the algorithm runs. So remember I explained initially that what happens is when you're training a model, let's say you have a data set of 100 images, and you have a convolutional neural network set up on those and you want to train this very new model that has not been trained on any other images, and you want to classify them between cats and dogs. So you have a 50 images of cats and 50 images of dogs, and you run this algorithm. You have all this labeled data, and first the algorithm actually trains on, say example, 40 images of cats and 40 images of dogs, and learns from this. Then later it validates on another set of 5 images, it's learning whether it has actually really learned the difference between cat and dog. So at the first iteration or at the first epoch, it will not do very well. So at the second epoch, so think of it as a cycle. It will make adjustments in its internal parameters, self-adjustments, and come back and do a little bit better. In the third epoch, it will do a little bit better. Fourth epoch, some more. It gradually gets better at a certain level of epochs. Now, this is a very complex thing to understand. I didn't want to get into it, but since you raised this question, I'm just going to try and explain. So say you set it for 100 epochs and the algorithm was doing better at each previous epochs, but at 70 or 80 epochs, it reaches a plateau. What that means is that think of it in your mind as a graph in which the algorithm is getting better exponentially, and then it starts getting better and it plateaus. So that is known as saturation. So algorithm has now achieved or reached its saturation value, and which it cannot get better on the data set that it has been provided with. So you either need to increase the number of images to increase the accuracy, or you want to better label the images. Another comment about epochs is, if you need to also, again, find the sweet spot of epochs. If you do too much training on those epochs, the model can get really, really better, but it will be only better on those images that it has been trained on and will not be generalizable. And we get into a trouble which is known as overfitting. But I think all these concepts are a little bit too complex for an introductory lecture. But I hope that answers your question.
Okay, it seems now we are ready to move to the clinical part.
So actually, this is some clinical, and then I will come back to new concepts also.
There is a question. Yeah. So before you go, please let me. Sir, can we use the same data set multiple times to improve the accuracy? And will the new accuracy apply to any new images that we load?
So again, coming back to, you can use the same data set in different epochs to increase the accuracy. But like I said, if it's a limited data set, at one time it will reach a plateau and will not improve its accuracy. Mm-hmm. And at that plateau, you have to stop the training. But if you keep training it more and more, it may become overfitted to that data set, will be very, very accurate on that side data set. But if you apply it on some other data set, what will happen is it may become overtrained and overfitted to that data set and may not have a generalizable result to another data set or a new unseen data set.
Okay, interesting. But let me ask another question, because it happens in my mind that we are just speaking about the images, but deep learning is not just images. It can be voices, or it can be even data from, for example, from the root canal. When we want to introduce a file inside a curved canal, we can look at the sensor and look at the force that the root canal applied to the files in instrument inside the canal and decide about the torque and change the torque and change the speed. That can be also a part of the machine learning. Am I right?
Yes, definitely.
And the algorithm is different at that time.
It would be a totally different algorithm. It wouldn't be a CNN.
Mm-hmm.
And to be honest, I'm not aware of what algorithm will be most useful in that scenario. My area of focus, and like I alluded to in the presentation also, is computer vision. So that's why all the algorithm that I've been talking about or will speak of would be related to computer vision tasks.
Yeah, so in that case, if I want to criticize the title of your article, I may say that you're just speaking the critical analysis of artificial intelligence in imaging in endodontics, not in every aspects of endodontics, because another aspect is electronic root canal length measurement devices that they use this artificial intelligence and deep learning as well. So they learn from the data that they get from each root canal in terms of the apical anatomy and detection of the endpoint or root canal terminus. And they send it to the one of the system or CPU of the system, and the CPU analyze it and add it up to the previous data set. So after, for example, a year, we can connect our electronic root canal length measurement devices, apex locators, to the web, to internet, and then make a new and upgrade the system based on all this data they gather to each other. So this is also artificial intelligence. Am I right?
True. But thank you for bringing up that question, Nikofar. In this review, however, that was included. I'm just saying that computer vision. I'm talking more about computer vision in this presentation, but when we talk about this article specifically, you will see back in 2012, Sahiri et al. Did this with artificial neural network, not a CNN, but with an artificial, which was very rudimentary form of neural network. So here you can see this is a very, it's a shallow neural network that was used for this back in 2012.
It's yeah, that's great.
Mentioned in our results here.
But this is just based on the imaging, not clinical.
No, this was not based on imaging. This was based on putting the file inside the root canal and determining the terminus, apical terminus manually, and then looking at it through a cross-section on cadavers.
Ah, I understand. Yeah. Comparing that with the reality. Very good. Very interesting.
Yeah.
And there is another question from Saman Wagar. Can you describe IOU intersections over union concept? I read an article about caries detection by deep learning, and they have used the term.
Yeah. Thank you for that question. So again, it's again an advanced concept. It's a performance metric. To look at or look for when we are studying artificial intelligence and particularly computer vision. So what happens is if you have, and I'm going to talk about it a little bit more further down this presentation, but just to answer the question quickly and maybe I'll elaborate a little bit more on when I do further down the presentation is, if you're looking at another problem, so right now I just gave you examples of classification problems. Another example, another problem in computer vision is identification problem. Identification meaning looking at an anatomy or certain anatomical feature from the background, or identifying a tooth. So, for example, if you want to identify a tooth on an OPG, and you've annotated it with a fluid margin. And you've taught the algorithm to look for that fluid margin. And then after you teach it that, and you look at the performance of that algorithm, you look at it in an overlapping manner. So the output of the algorithm and your actual annotation, you overlap it and see how much of the prediction from the algorithm overlaps your original annotation. And this is represented mathematically by a performance metric known as intersection over union.
It hasn't got any difference between occlusal or proximal caries for that. Is there any difference?
No. So if, for example, if you want to identify occlusal or proximal caries and somebody has demarcated occlusal caries, I'll just take the occlusal caries example forward. Or somebody has demarcated proximal caries on a bite wing X-ray, for example.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's move on. Thanks for answering the question. Oh, your brain is full of knowledge. Fantastic. Thank you very much.
I'm going to come back to this, completing this question. IOU, so if somebody is demarcated or labeled proximal caries on a bite wing X-ray, and you've taught the algorithm to look for it, and you run this bite wing X-ray through the algorithm will also make a prediction demarcating the proximal caries on the X-ray. And now you want to see whether the demarcation that was done by the algorithm matches with the demarcation that was done by the subject specialist or annotator. You overlap it. And see if the overlapping, how much of an overlapping is actually occurring and how much overlapping is not occurring. This is known as intersection over union. I hope that answers the question.
Thank you very much.
Just to summarize.
There are lots of questions, obviously, if we want to discuss such a things, because again, the standardization of the radiographs are also very important. We make it parallel radiographs or bisecting radiographs may have some effect also on the machine learning, and it we need actually to always to make a standard radiograph when we want to give it to the machine. Am I right?
So that's a very, very interesting question. Not really, no. The answer is not really no. I'm saying not really no because if you train the deep learning algorithm on enough examples of different kind of radiograph with different orientation, different machines, different angulations, it will learn to pick it up as long as these are good quality labeled examples with different orientations. But at the same time, your point well taken. If an algorithm is trained on radiographs, which were always almost parallel and done with, cone indicators, it may not be able to generalize well on X-rays, which were not done on cone indicators. And that's why it is very, very important for for deep learning engineers to include all the possible examples and as much examples that they can, because these deep learning algorithms are very, very data hungry. The more data and different kind of training examples you will give to that algorithm, the better it will get. The algorithms are very susceptible to subtle nuances like change in brightness and colors. And therefore, when we are training the algorithm, what we do is we do a process known as augmentation. In augmentation, what we do is we change the orientation. If, for example, I have one radiograph, it is parallel. We also change the orientation of the X-rays when we are teaching it to the algorithm. This actually helps us increasing our data set. We change the brightness. We change different aspects and aspect ratios of the X-rays. So this gives us more training examples to teach the algorithm. And by doing this, this makes the algorithm a little bit more robust.
Thank you. Amazing. And also there was a lot of thanks and a lot of appreciation so far. And they say that very well, very well. Thank you very much. Very well replied. I also thought that picture radiographs must be a standardized. So people are very happy about your description. Very informative. We appreciate that. Thank you very much, Dr. Fahd Omar. Please carry on.
So I'm not
you are also question. Very hungry to learn from you. Thank like you your so machine much. That they are hungry for the data. We are hungry for your data.
I'm also very enthusiastic to teach this.
Good, good. Carry on.
All right. I'm just going to summarize this really quickly because we spent almost 2 hours last time that we sat on just this topic. So in endodontics, what we noticed was that machine learning as well as deep learning actually has been there since 2012. But is from 2012 till 2017, the artificial intelligence models that were used at that time were very fairly rudimentary. So like Sahiri et al. Used a shallow network for determination of apical terminus. Some other people used machine learning models for discovering and identifying periapical pathology. But after 2017, in 2019 and 2020, deep learning has been the main artificial intelligence model that's being used. It is being used for different endodontic problems, such as identifying pathology, periapical pathology, root fractures, identification of different types of roots. What we noticed is that most of the deep learning algorithms that were used were actually CNNs, convolutional neural networks. And it made sense because these were the algorithms which are doing well in computer vision technologies. We also noticed that all the AI models reported good results, but there was no benchmark result that we looked for. For example, and we've alluded to in our article too, that is it okay for an algorithm to be 90% accurate as opposed to, let's say, 96% accurate? What is the benchmark? What should we be looking at? This is something that we as an endodontic community need to sit together and see, okay, you know what, an algorithm which is working at 83 and the study says that its performance is acceptable, is it really acceptable or should we look for a 96% performance? So these are things that need further work. Also, what we noticed that the algorithms were very narrow and task specific. So a pathology discovering algorithm would only look for pathology, but would not look for the relating anatomy. And this got me thinking a little bit more. So we looked at the image automation challenge and or image automation puzzle. And from our perspective, we're looking at, we thought maybe OPG is a good starting point from our perspective, as in for image automation. And we wanted to automate this image processing. So we said, okay, since OPG is being done most common X-ray, let's use it to identify disease and also relate that disease to the anatomy, which is teeth. And in order to relate it to the anatomy or teeth, we need to start identifying the anatomy in the OPG. So this brings us to the image identification task. In computer vision, image identification can be done in three ways. One way and most easy way to detect something in an image is known as an object detection. What that essentially means is you make a bounding box around an object of interest. It has certain advantages. It's an easier task to do. And it also gives you the spatial orientation of the object of interest in that image. It can tell you the height as well as the width of the object of interest in that image. So look at these chicks, for example. Different chicks have different heights and widths. And we can tell, okay, the one chick is on the left side, other one on the right side. You can identify it for us. But the problem with object detection is that it doesn't separate the chick image from the background. So as a researcher in healthcare, we want to isolate the disease from the background or the other anatomy so that we can identify it better, especially when it comes to periapical pathology or for that matter cancers. So and in another intuitive way of doing that is to do it at a pixel level. So what is essentially done at a pixel level is known as a semantic segmentation. A semantic segmentation actually identifies each pixel and labels it to that object of interest. And therefore, you're able to draw fluid margins around the object of interest here, like so. And also, you know, identify it from the background. But at the same time, this can be problematic, especially in OPGs, and I'll talk about it more in the next slide. When we do it, we are not able to separate four chicks from one another. If we want to do that at a pixel level, another identification solution is known as instant segmentation. It not only separates the objects of interest from the background, but also separate similar objects of the same class from one another. Such a task is known as instant segmentation. Now, if we look at it on an OPG, and say, for example, we got an example A, which is an unannotated OPG, and we want to look at teeth. One intuitive way of looking at it is to make bounding boxes around all teeth. But again, the problem is that when we make bounding boxes, it may be useful if we want to identify number teeth. But if we want to identify number teeth as well as separate it from the background and relate it to something else, it may not be a useful solution. So one way of doing it is now the other way is segmenting it. And if we segment it, but we are not able to individualize these, it's not also good for us. And therefore, the best way to do it in OPGs was instant segmentation. And therefore, with that problem in our mind, we wanted to do a literature search, and we wanted to see what kind of image identification modalities are being used on OPGs and what are their performances. And therefore, we set to do a systematic review on that. And this was only recently published in Journal of Oral Maxillofacial Radiology. And what we noticed that all three types of tasks were being used. And again, all of them had good outcomes. But when they were identifying teeth, they were either not numbering it. Some were just doing object detection, others were doing instance segmentation, and very few were doing semantic segmentation. And this made us think more about it. And since we started off, when I wanted to do, or when I wanted to make an algorithm to identify disease, I thought it didn't make sense to identify disease on its own. I wanted to relate it to anatomy. And therefore, I thought it'd be more useful if we start solving this problem by first identifying the anatomy. And myself and my colleague, Dr. Neha, along with a computer engineer, decided to make a computer-based algorithm which would be able to identify the teeth by instance segmentation. That means that identify each teeth separately and give a number to that. And we were able to do that by utilizing two different kind of CNNs. One CNN is known as the RCNN or faster RCNN. The faster RCNN helped us annotate the teeth or give a number to that teeth according to the FDI system. And I'm not going to talk too much detail about the architecture. It's beyond the scope of this presentation today. The other algorithm, which is known as a UNET, was also leveraged for instance segmentation task. And we especially use UNET because we wanted to leverage our network on a small data set, because we did not have access to good quality OPG annotated data set. So we had to go about doing it ourselves, annotating the OPGs ourselves. Unfortunately, in dentistry, we do not have data sets available to us like for other fields. They have big, large data sets, open source available to them to train their algorithms. But this is another thing that we want to highlight and another area of research that needs to be worked on. So coming back to our model, this was totally made in-house with our own resources. And so we set about annotating 40 OPGs, and we trained our algorithms, and we got really, really good results. We were able to classify teeth according to FDI by bounding boxes. Our classification was 93.8% accurate. And here you can see, and somebody had asked me this question, what is an IOU? Our IOU for this case was in UNET for segmentation, instant segmentation was 86.3%, which means that whenever our teeth were overlapping with the annotation, the algorithm was 86.3% accurate in overlapping with the original annotation. So these were really, really good results, and these were very encouraging. And now what we are hoping to do next is we're going to leverage the same algorithm with disease identification. With that being said, I want to give the audience or the listeners and some intuition about transformers. To date, all my talk has been about CNNs or convolutional neural networks. But something new is coming up. AI is a field, and especially deep learning is a field that you have to be in touch with all the time, because newer algorithms are coming up which are better than the previous algorithm. And something similar has happened with transformers. Transformer is a deep learning algorithm that came to fore in 2017. And I'll just give you a brief background. Remember, I spoke at the in the middle of the presentation about how different kind of algorithms are used for different tasks such as computer vision. Likewise, some colleagues were working on natural language processing. What natural language processing actually is looking at sentences, learning those sentences, and using them for example, tasks such as translation, that is being done in Google Translate, or understanding grammar, etc. So our colleagues in natural language processing had hit a dead end, and they were not making any progress in natural language processing, because at that time, the best algorithm that they had available to them were recurrent neural networks and LSTM. The problem with recurrent neural networks was that they were looking at text sequentially. So for example, if I would say, I like a dog, or I love dogs, the recurrent neural network would sequentially look at this word, I love dogs, and then make an output, okay, he loves dogs. But the problem with recurrent neural network was that they had short memory. So if they were given problems or tasks in which longer sentence cases were there, they were not able to work well with longer paragraphs. So say, for example, if I were using to say, I love dogs, and of them, Labrador Retriever is my favorite dog type. It may catch up till the I love dog, and then when it goes to the I love, or dog retriever is the favorite dog type, it forget that I said I love dogs. It would forget that. So therefore, there was this big problem. And then something happened in 2017, just like an ImageNet movement. Someone came up with this paper, which says attention is all you need. And I'll explain how this works and how that is translated into computer vision also. So this paper was published in 2017. And based on this paper, Google made BERT, which is one of the most famous natural language processing algorithm. And it has since then had a progeny of Roberta, Ernie, all the Sesame Street characters. So how it works? So remember I spoke about how recurrent neural network look at text only in sequence. And when they are dealing with bigger text, they only have one GPU, which could not be used in parallel. So they had to figure out some problem or some way of sorting this problem. So a transformer has three main domains in it. One is a positional encoding. The other thing is attention. And the third thing is self-attention. So what positional encoding meant was, if there is a sentence which says, I love books, it would add numbers to it. One being I, two being love, and three being books. So that the orientation of this sequence of text is not lost. It is very, very important, especially in text, that the sequence is not lost. And so they added this positional encoding bit in their algorithm. The other thing that they added was attention. What does this mean? This meant that if we are to read this sentence, the European Economic Area, it is very important when you translate it into another language, it should be translated in a manner in which it is actually said in that language. So in Farsi, it would be European would come at the end of the sentence. Likewise, in French, it comes at the end of the sentence. But here in English, it comes at the start. So it was able to pay attention to these important words. And another important thing that came in transformers was self-attention. What that meant is that the algorithm was also able to put context in those statements or realize the context in that statement. So for example, if I say fair checking was done was undertaken during examination, and I also say the annual fair was conducted on 4th of May. So this is the word fair has different meaning when we look at it from different contexts. So it means differently for different sentences, cases. And therefore, what happens is the algorithm looks at not only the word fair, but also surrounding words around it and makes an assumption of what it actually means. So these were the three breakthrough things that were added in a transform. So how does that translate to vision or computer vision? So this breakthrough later translated into computer vision by a paper which speaks about or talks about an image is worth 16 by 16 words. So how and they showed that computer vision transformers, sorry, vision transformers actually outperformed CNNs in their outputs. And this was done very intuitively. What they did was they made 16 by 16 patches of each image. This means that each image had patches of 16 by 16 pixels. Sorry, not 16 by 16 patches, but patches of 16 by 16 pixels. And then these pixels or these patches actually went under a linear transformation. They were straightened up, given a positional embedding, and would then go through the transformer. And the transformer will give attention to that contextual relationship and will never lose the contextual relationship that was at times lost in CNN, because CNN looks at an image at a micro level, but the transformer actually first looks at the whole image and then breaks it down into smaller image patches and then processes it in a faster manner. And therefore, the transformer is able to train on huge data sets. So what does that mean for CNNs? Is the age of CNN gone? Not really. Reason for that is with transformers, what is happening is that they are able to work well if they are trained on very, very big data sets. And they will do, if you have a lot of computational power available to you. But when you have smaller data sets, and if you have smaller computational power available to you, you will not be able to leverage a transformer into better outputs or better results. And therefore, transformers are able to do really, really well in the big challenges such as the ImageNet challenge. But in real life scenarios and real life issues, they have certain issues, certain problems that we need resolving and require further research. I just wanted to give an intuition to all the audience about transformers, because newer papers that will be coming up may talk about these transformers, and it's very important for them to have a little bit of an intuition what they entail. So work in progress for us here at AKUH is we've already done instant segmentation and tooth numbering. Our next task is to make a dental image data sets known as AKUID. We hope to make a data set in which we can have larger images from different X-ray machines, showing different kind of X-ray scenarios in OPG. And it should be properly annotated and curated so that later on it can be made available to the dental community who wants to research on it or leverage their all algorithms against it, so that the scientific community can, or dental or endodontic community can focus on actually doing the core science rather than annotating data. Further to that, our future goal is like I already alluded to, instant segmentation tooth numbering. We want to do pathology detection using CNN, which is very important in endodontics. We want to annotate this pathology using image captioning or using natural language processing. And we also want to look at the temporal relationship using serial radiographs. So for example, if there's a pathology and we did a root canal, we want to see if the pathology healed or is not healed. We want the algorithm to tell us if this is an improvement or a failure. There are a number of challenges that our community faces. We have very many ethical concerns. So for example, if we have OPG X-rays, whom does these OPG X-rays belong to? Do they belong to the institution? Do they belong to the patient? Do they belong to the curators? These are questions that need to be answered, because large data sets means that they are valuable now that we know the algorithms are data hungry, and the more data we feed them, the better performance they will give. We also need to look at the scientific robustness of the papers that are coming out, especially in our community. We want to make certain guidelines and standards. The Equator Network is working on making these guidelines and standards that should be followed in doing primary research in artificial intelligence. Another aspect that has not been studied is cost effectiveness of these algorithms. Now that we understand that these algorithms require large data sets, require subject specialists to some degree to label this data, as well as leverage these algorithms on larger GPUs. So R&D requires a lot of cost that goes into developing these algorithms. So are they really going to be cost effective? And we also want to highlight that these algorithms have a sort of like a black box effect. What that means is, if an algorithm comes to a decision, we are not sometimes sure that how did it make that decision. So in areas in which it may be difficult to diagnose disease, say periapical index 2 compared to human annotator, the human annotator, if this algorithm become mainstream, may not be able to question the outcome of an algorithm and may be subject to an automation bias. So these are certain challenges that our community has to be aware of and look towards. So to conclude, AI applications in dentistry in general are still at a nascent stage. The recent upsurge in AI constitute deep learning, of which CNN are the most widely used algorithms. The performance of AI models are promising, but are very, very focused and task specific. So therefore, we are not able to package it and deploy it in terms of a useful application just yet. A lot of work still needs and has to be done for this technology to translate into clinical practice. With that being said, I again thank Professor Nico for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to have this webinar and present my talk. I would also like to thank Ms. Malihe Aladini, as well as Ms. Zora Sadeghi for helping us out with this webinar. If the audience has any further questions, please feel free to ask me.
Dr. Fahad, thank you very much. First of all, let me thank you, because you did a great job, very, very difficult, obviously, but very great job, because the topic is very difficult. The topic is very, very interesting. It is a hot topic, obviously. And I'm sure there are a lot of suggestions for collaborating with you, because now I'm 100% sure that when I say you are a world authority in this field, you showed a lot of evidence that you are the one. So I'm sure you're going to receive a lot of suggestions from all of the participants and all of the researchers from around the world to work with you. And hopefully you are going to solve a lot of future problem in this field to give a better service to patients. And also I have received some comments that many people or some of the participants are not dentists and they are engineers. So they like actually to work with you and they like to communicate with you. They ask me to send your connection or the way that they can connect to you. You may share them right now if you like. Give them your, I don't know, maybe your email or whatever they can reach you through that. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much.
They ask me to send it to them. I don't have permission from you. If I have permission from you,
I'm just gonna go ahead and put that up in the slide here.
Okay, great.
Yeah, you can reach out to me. On my email address. Uh, I'm just gonna go ahead and share my screen now. So that's my email address right there. I'm also available on Twitter. My handle is Dr. Fahad Umar, and you can reach out to me on Twitter also if you wish to. I'm just gonna go ahead and put my Twitter handle there too. Yes, I am always very willing to collaborate and work with engineers, especially. We are always on the lookout for engineers because otherwise, at this point in time, I've reached a situation in which I am trying to learn the software part as well. Something I don't know if that's time well spent on doing the software background work or not, but yes, always looking forward to engineers who want to work on a problem with us.
Yep, great. So they already have now your email, and I already send my own way to connect to me, and then I can send them to you as well. So
great.
They all have the information that they need right now. Thank you very much. So I wish you were here, or I was there to give you actually the certification of your talk right now in person. But unfortunately, because of the problem of still COVID-19 around the world, however, it is almost settled. So hopefully we can travel and we can invite you to come and give us lecture in the future face to face. But we prepared actually a certificate. So I ask my colleague, okay, to send the certificate to you to show our appreciation. And thank you very much for accepting our invitation and sharing your knowledge with all of us. And I'm looking forward for future work with you. I believe if there is any question, no, I cannot see any question in the chat box so far. So we can end the meeting by saying thank you to you. And I'm going to ask all the participants to turn on and unmute themselves and put their hand together for saying thanks to Professor Fahad Umar. Thank you very much for sharing your knowledge with us. Thank you very much, Indita. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so very much for having me. Indeed, I think it's a great platform for our community as well as, you know, our region to exchange our ideas. And obviously this will go a long way towards, you know, making and building collaborative relationships among universities. I think Tehran University is a wonderful university, is a wonderful history, and a great future ahead of it. And I think I'm honored to work with the people at your university.
Thank you. So on Friday, we are going to have our online journal club about the root canal sealers, the bioceramics and calcium silicate based root canal sealers. So we will see you all over there, and hope to have a very nice time in this evening. Thank you very much, and goodbye, Dr. Fahad.
Thank you. Goodbye.